better that we actually did that.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable?
I'm fine.
Because I don't have to be getting as much as you because you're doing the talking. I'm just getting comments.
I'm fine.
Okay, let's see if I can make this work.
So you can see it on there.
Yeah.
I'm gonna grab another book, so
I'm gonna refresh it. Maybe I don't do something. The A is the vibe. Yes, good vibes only. I love vibes. Hit me right, baby. I hate to read. I might just have to read a comment from there, but I really hate doing that. Hello, everyone. Hello. There is a delay, so I'm just gonna look at the comments just FYI. There is a delay.
Okay.
Okay. So I guess we can get three people. Let's get it started. Hello, everyone. I hope you guys are staying safe and healthy during COVID and everything that we have going on. Tonight, I have my sister, my colleague, Dr. Flowers.
Hi, ladies.
So she's going to be talking about some hot topics that we have right now. If you guys have any input or anything that you would like to discuss briefly, just put it in the comments, okay? And we can discuss it or we can send you some resources if we don't have enough time. Because we have curfew here. And we gotta make sure Dr. Flowers gets across that water before 8 p.m. Okay? So whenever you're ready.
Hi, ladies. As she said, I'm Dr. Theresa Flowers, and I am a licensed clinical social worker, and I'm the owner of Seed of Faith Counseling and Services in Little Rock, Arkansas. And I'm excited to be speaking with you ladies tonight and eager to answer any questions, provide any feedback, help find resources that you all might need, and just help out in any way that I can. Because I know things are crazy for everybody right now. So I wanted to start off, one of the things that we were planning to talk about is just around COVID-19. I know that there's a lot of concern. It's a lot of changes for people, especially parents, single parents, when you are having to raise kids at home, still having to figure out work, and now the added level of teaching from home, it creates a very different dynamic. And so I think that it's important to kind of flush out and address those issues. So any specific questions you have concerning any of that, feel free to post in the comments and we will address it. But, excuse me. So one of the first things I want to address is keeping yourself sane, because if you don't maintain your well-being, you can't pour from an empty cup. This is something I learned very early on. If there's nothing in the cup, there's nothing to pour into anyone else. And so if you allow yourself to run dry, if you allow yourself to be depleted, you won't have anything to give to a job, to give to your kids, or give to anyone else. And so it's really, really important to do some self-care stuff. And I know self-care has kind of become this cliche topic, but it's still a real thing and it's still important. And so it's not just, you know, with COVID-19, a lot of us may have went to get our nails done or get our hair done, went I went and got massages. I went to the chiropractor. I did a lot of things that really focused on my physical health, but it also helped me with my mental health. And so with COVID-19, you can't do a lot of that. Some people are still very cautious about going to the hair salon or going to the nail salon to do some of those things. So we're creating new normals. And so if you ladies don't mind, can you kind of share with me and share with us what you're currently doing to take care of yourself in the midst of all of this and how you're kind of managing?
I'll go first. We had a Blurred Lines color and sip party for our 1-year anniversary. So I have two coloring books in my room, coloring pencils that my children are not allowed to touch. And I use that to help me relax. And I bought a TV for my room so that I can watch Netflix. So that's really what I've been doing. Because I like the nails. I think things are just opening back up, but I really have a babysitter. And then I used to sneak out on my lunch breaks while they were in school. They're not in school anymore. Mm-hmm. So that's what I do. I just try to find things to do that are just for me, especially when they're asleep. So those are two things that I do. Oh, and reading my Bible. I forgot. Sorry, Lord. Journaling, just finding hobbies and different certifications and things to do and to get, that's keeping me sane through all of this.
So one thing I kind of want to mention as well is that for some people, it can be difficult or challenging to find hobbies, or people think that everything has to cost money. Mm-hmm. And Pinterest is one of my favorite things ever. Mm-hmm. I am a person who likes to craft, so I also will go to the Dollar Tree and buy up some stuff and go home and make stuff just because I'm a creative. So when mm-hmm. I create in that kind of way, it helps me to kind of relax and just focus on myself. I also enjoy baking. So like this weekend, I'm baking a vegan chocolate cake just because I've been wanting to attempt it, and I just want to make it and master it. And I enjoy baking, so that's going to be one of the ways in which I create to relax and kind of have some me time and give me a chance to just unplug from the busyness of everything.
We have become one mom. Felicia said, I like taking soothing baths and showers with candles. That's another thing I do. Ooh, bubble baths. Yes. Put a little music on. My Lord.
So yes. Let me say to that, too, that's mm-hmm. a perfect example. And it's also another thing that you can do to help your body. Like, our body needs to detox and de-stress. So add some Epsom salt in there, add some baking soda, and that helps with the detoxification process. And so it's a great way to allow your body and mind to kind of relax and de-stress. And candles, aromatherapy is amazing. Essential oils are great if you use those. And so I see another one, sitting in a dark room listening to water sounds helps me. This is so funny. We just had a conversation.
We talked about it at work. And she actually told me about it, and I've been fighting it for about 6 months. So I love the beach, and I listen to my ocean waves. And it has to be dark. So the screen is dark because I don't like the light. Mm-hmm. And that's what I do, and I've been sleeping like a baby. Mm-hmm. And I love it.
And just a way to relax. So mm-hmm. that's another awesome way. Anybody else have any other things that you're doing during this time? And so I'll wait for other comments, but and if we see it, we'll address it.
Okay.
So I think, so taking that time to take care of yourself. Journaling is great for those people who like to write. I have journals, and what I have found is that I go through these seasons where I can't write it. But I do keep them for moments when something come up and I go, I need to document this because mm-hmm. I want to be able to come back later and see how I made it through this stage and phase of my life. And that's been very beneficial for me. Singing, dancing, I sing around the house and all that fun stuff. So finding mm-hmm. something for you. Talking to someone, and not just anybody. One thing that I recognize is that everyone isn't going to understand what you're going through right now. talking to people who don't have children, talking to people who aren't single parents may not be helpful because they can't relate in some way. So they tell you what they think they would do, but it's a different experience when it's you who are living it. So I see we have a question, and so I want to get some clarification.
It says, what are healthy ways of handling rejection? So you need to clarify that. So,
well, not even. Okay. Because I think no matter whether it's a friendship, relationship mm-hmm. with an intimate partner mm-hmm. or family member or anyone, rejection can be very hard and none of us like it. Mm-hmm. I don't care how confident people are. I don't, you know. We see people like Halle Berry and the Beyoncés of the world, and even these people have dealt with a form of rejection for whatever reason. And so I think some key points to handling rejection in a healthy manner is, one, is not to internalize it. Oftentimes when someone rejects us, we want to look at ourselves and say, what is it about me that I'm not enough?
Exactly.
And so this is where it's important to build your self-worth and your self-esteem, because when you have a healthy sense of who you are and what you deserve, and I'm not one of those people like, well, I deserve because da 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 da. No, being a full human being a woman, there are some basic levels to things that I deserve. And then on top of that, I know I'm dope. Not because somebody told me, because I know I am.
Yes.
Not because I got a degree. I've been dope since 84. Period. And I mean it.
Yes.
So, but you wouldn't have always heard that from me with that level of confidence and belief. Not just saying it. Some people say this cliche stuff and they don't even believe it. And so when you don't believe it is when you have to do that internal work. So I think people handle rejection better when they have a healthy sense of self. You have to figure out who you are. You have to figure out what works for you. And you have to learn yourself. One thing that I have found is that a lot of people don't even like themselves. We have to learn how to like us. That means we have to learn how to sit with ourselves, be with ourselves. And I get it. We are communal people. We were created to be in relationships with others. And it can be hard to be by yourself in any aspect of life, not just relationships, but not having friends. That's alarming. I believe that even if you just have one good friend, every person should have at least one friend. Healthy relationships in our families, having one person in your family you could talk to. Sometimes that isn't possible, and I understand the multiple layers to that, but I do also encourage people to look at their relationships in general and try to figure out, well, are all my relationships like this, or is it just that one? And I'm talking about that because that entails how we deal with rejection. When you can deal with yourself and other people reject you, people may not like Brother Kanye, but Kanye gave us some wisdom. He said, everything I'm not makes me everything I am. So for everything that someone doesn't like about me, doesn't appreciate about me, somebody else does and will.
Okay.
I'm talkative. I will talk your ear off, and I know it. Sometimes in my head, I go, girl, ooh, stop talking so much. You're talking a lot. Ooh, take a breather. But guess what? That's a part of who I am. I've been this way since I was a child. Those people who don't like that about me, we just don't communicate. It's okay. And don't call my phone when you need something either. Mm-hmm.
Keep the same energy.
Keep that same energy. Or when you call my phone, I'm going to send you an invoice since I talk so much. Mm-hmm. Okay. Not being funny with people, I'm being real.
Exactly.
Because I've learned we have to accept the other people in our lives for who they are. And so I've learned that when people can't accept me for who I am, they don't appreciate who I am, what I bring to the table, I have learned that when people reject me, I go, they rejected a blessing for themselves.
Right. And they didn't even know.
I'm a good friend. I know, Miss Ross. I know. I know I'll be talking your ear off. Bless you.
Yes, we love bless you, Miss Ross.
So, but I know that I'm a good person. I know that I'm a good friend. I know that I'm there for the people who are in my life. So when people walk away from me, I also recognize that, one, sometimes people walking away from us isn't rejection of us, it's protection of them.
Yes.
And that's okay. People have the right to protect themselves. People have the right to not be in relation with us. Mm-hmm. Even if it hurts us, we have to learn to recognize that. And to recognize that don't nobody owe us anything, because I keep that same energy. If you were not good for me, for whatever reason, I'm gonna go on about my business, and that's okay. And so I have to give people that same space mm-hmm. to operate in that. So the short answer to dealing with rejection is knowing your worth and being okay with the fact that you're not for everybody. You know how many different types of breads they got out there? Different types of tea? Because everything ain't for everybody. Some people like drier bread. Some people like fluffy bread. Some people like flavored bread. Same thing with tea. Some people just want it straight up, no chaser. They want it dark. They want it black. They want it green. I want to be variety of spice of life. So I have tons of teas because I like that. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. So recognizing that with people and not taking everything so personal and internalizing about who you are at your being, when you find yourself doing that, you have to start asking yourself, where does this come from? What's the root of that? And so when you can get to the root of a thing, then you can heal from it. A lot of times we are responding and reacting to people out of a hurt place mm-hmm. because we haven't done the work and we want them to just fit this little vision we have. And when that doesn't happen, it's disappointing. So that's kind of my take on that as far as dealing with the rejection piece.
Does anyone else have any more questions? Just put in the comments and we'll address those questions that you have.
Okay. So also surrounding COVID-19, keeping yourself safe. So I'm one of those people, I'm high exposure. I work, do they know where you work?
Yes, they do know where I work.
Okay.
It's okay.
So I work at Job Corps. I'm a mental health consultant, and I also work at Children's Hospital, and I also do online therapy right now. I have a private practice, but I'm not seeing people at my office with that. But one of the things about staying safe, I speak to doctors and I know people personally, so we have these conversations, because in the beginning they were saying, oh, I don't know if the mask are even needed, if it makes sense. Mm-hmm. And so I don't even know if it's going to protect anything or not. So since that time, more research has been done mm-hmm. and research professionals are saying that, hey, we believe that this helps to decrease your risk of being exposed or mm-hmm. contracting the virus if you have a mask when you're in large public spaces. As you see, we're sitting here beside each other. We work together. We see each other a few times a week. Mm-hmm. So they know I work at the hospital. I'm open and honest about any exposures I might have had or potential exposures. And we have what I call, we take educated risk and have healthy conversations. And so we talked about this today. Mm-hmm. When I say educated risk, I'm not talking about, oh, I just know the consequence, so I'm gonna just do what I want. That's a part of it, but the consequence for this can be deadly. So mm-hmm. you really wanna take precautions that if you don't have a mask, go get you one. There are people selling them for $5 or $10. If you're not able to afford a mask, then, let us know. We will help you get one. Mm-hmm. Make sure your children have a mask, and you also want to make sure that you get something for them that fits their face. Mm-hmm. You do not want to give a mask to any child that's under 2 years old. They will not be able to breathe properly. So you want to make sure you take that So you have to keep that in consideration. Mm-hmm. And so gloves. Here's my thing about the gloves, y'all.
Don't do it.
Stop.
Stop.
People wearing these gloves in the store. So
maybe like this cell phone.
Everything.
I'm like, rubbing their face. Everything.
You rubbing your face.
I'm driving in the car.
I'm like, you just got in your car with the gloves on. You touched everything in the store, yes, that everybody else touched.
You are
better off, mm-hmm, getting what you need at the store. What COVID has taught me is that I go to the store and get what I need now. I used to be queen of picking up a bunch of stuff. And being like, oh, I don't think I want this now. And putting it back. I'm like, ma'am, you need to make a list and get what you need and get out of here. Mm-hmm. And so let this help you be more directed, that when you go in the store, you go to get what you need and you get on out.
Also, I do pick up because I have, 5 and 3-year-olds, so I try to limit my exposure to people. That's why I took so long to do a live, because I'm like, I'm going to take a risk with this. So now I feel a little bit more comfortable now that I'm more educated about COVID. More research has been done, but we do pick up. I do contact a list delivery to my door. They'll ring the doorbell and leave my groceries. So there's other ways, because I'm high risk with my health condition. So and then I have small kids. So I'm very careful. I've turned a lot of birthday parties, a lot of invitations. People mad at me. You be mad all you want to, but these are my children. And if they get sick, who gonna be up? Me, not you. Okay.
Right.
So it is what it is.
Yeah.
One of my friends, she put that she needs counseling bad. She lost her dad due to COVID-19 April 13th. So maybe, I don't know if you have some encouraging words for her, then some resources we can possibly give her to find,
yes,
a counselor. Okay.
First off, my condolences. This has required us to grieve differently, because people are not able to get together and have community the way that we're used to. And so, first off, I commend you for being transparent and sharing, because that can be hard to share. And also for saying that you need counseling. People act like life, we should just be okay. And it's okay to not be okay. Mm-hmm. Most of us are not okay right now. Like, I'm okay in this moment.
But I have my times,
yeah,
my highs and lows. And I let myself feel it, and I won't work if I don't feel like working. Like if I'm at home or I order food, I have to make sure my mental health is okay, especially as a single parent.
Yes.
I have to take care of my mental health.
And so what I can do is, I'll say this, and then if you are looking for a specific type of therapist, one thing I tell people, finding a therapist is like finding a nice pair of jeans. You want to find one that fits you. And look, that works for you. And so I personally knew that I need a black male therapist. Oh, I'm a therapist with a therapist. I believe in that. I'm ready for, yes, the 15th.
I have a therapist too. And I'm, yeah, a life coach and a whole bunch of other stuff, but I have a therapist.
And so, mm-hmm, it is, so one resource that I'll share, that we have online resources. So the first thing I'll say to you is, if you are employed and you work for a company, the first thing I encourage you to do is find out if you have what's called an EAP. It's an employee assistance program. Usually EAPs offer therapy. Right now, I work at the hospital part-time, and I'm only there every other weekend, and I still get the benefit of the EAP, mm-hmm, and I can get free therapy sessions up to a certain point, and then they could connect me. If I'm lucky, your insurance, the provider who you see through the EAP might provide you, might accept your insurance, and you could continue with them. And so that's the first thing I tell people. Utilize your resources and get as much stuff free as you can.
Mm-hmm.
These are some of the benefits of working for a company. So I would definitely check with my company to see if we had an EAP. Your HR personnel would be able to make you aware of that. And sometimes they have it and they just don't tell people. Ask them folks and let them tell you no. Secondly, looking for a therapist. So Psychology Today, there are plenty of African American black sites that advertise for therapists, what I'm finding is that in the state of Arkansas, and I guess this is an assumption on mine that everybody's from Arkansas. If not, then if you're looking for services in a specific state, then we can look at that. But there's black, I believe it's Black Girls in Therapy, and they have a website. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And so they have a site where Therapy for Black Girls. Thank you.
No problem.
So Therapy for Black Girls is a website you can go to see who is in your area, who says that they work with grief. And so you want to find a therapist to fit your needs for whatever your main issue is. Some people think, oh, I go to therapy and I can throw everything out there. You could throw some stuff, but it's a process. So we pick the main issue, and then we kind of work from there of what are some of the underbelly things that might be going on. So finding a good therapist, and a good therapist, when you reach out to them, will ask you, what are you seeking therapy for? And what is it you're hoping to get from this? And they can let you know if they can meet your needs or not. So I definitely would recommend looking at that. And then Psychology Today also is a great resource where you can look for therapists and you can specify certain things, and they will narrow down the focus to help you, especially if you're looking for therapists of color. We are out here in these streets. We here. And there are tons of therapists and tons of black therapists and ton of women therapists and people who are culturally competent to meet whatever need you may have. And so I recognize that not all persons of color want a therapist of color, but it's important for you to kind of know what your needs are. And so that's important. Okay.
Shanika, a co-founder, she couldn't make it tonight, and she sends her love. She had a prior engagement, but she said Kitty Robinson on Pulaski Street downtown is a really good therapist. So she said she went through her job through EAP.
Good. Right. Thank you for sharing that.
Mm-hmm.
And so definitely know, I think one of the things right now, some of the therapists I know, I think are we're at capacity with COVID going on, with the protests and the racial injustice going on. More people are recognizing that they need someone to talk to, and they need someone to hold space in a non-judgmental manner. And that's definitely one of the benefits of therapy, on top of learning additional tools to put in your toolbox. I always tell people, none of us know everything. We can all learn from others. And so for me, therapy is the place to go where I get to be in a non-judgmental space, because there's no expectation about who I am and what I should and shouldn't feel, because, oh, you're so smart, you shouldn't be sad, which is foolishness. So,
well, you're a therapist.
Oh, my baby sister, we were talking and I said, I got therapy. And she was like, I thought you were a therapist. I said, I am a therapist. I'm a therapist with a therapist. I said, it's important. Mm-hmm. I take on a lot of people's stuff, just like parents, single moms. You ladies take on a lot of stuff. Yeah, you might have some help, but day in, day out, baby sick, it's on you. You got to go to work. You got to clock in. You got to clock out. You got to take care of yourself. You got to take care of that child. And then you got to live. The world doesn't stop resolving. And so you have to make sure that you are holding space for yourself and giving yourself the opportunity for other people to hold space for you too. It's okay to talk to someone else and just let it out and not try to carry it on your own. A lot of people are in the hospital. A lot of people are getting sick, and a lot of people are going to die early because they refuse to release what is going on with them. So it definitely is important to have that additional support, because sometimes people say, it's going to be okay. Well, it don't feel like it right now, and it's okay for it not to be okay right now. It's okay to feel overwhelmed. It's okay to be sad. It is okay. And sometimes, I think a lot of times we need permission to not be okay, because mm-hmm. we have this sense that we're strong Black women. I be telling folks I'm just a Black woman.
Exactly.
I get sad. I have my weak moments. Yes, I'm strong, but I ain't strong like y'all be trying mm-hmm. to say. I don't carry the world on my shoulders. Mm-hmm. Nope. Everybody ain't climbing on my back. I'm not doing it.
And I think another thing is being vocal about your needs. Like, I'll tell my kids, look, I'm tired. I don't know if I'm ready to do it today. You're going to come over. You're going to do something. You're going to go get them something. I tell my mom, my sister, my support system, I'm not okay. I'm tired. Who going to help me? Because if something happened to me, y'all would have my own time anyway. So who coming today? That's the reality of it. If something happens to me, they're going to go with their dad or my mother. That's just the reality of it. So I'm like, I need some help. So be vocal about it. It's no, don't be shamed because you're struggling. Be vocal and let your village know that you need help. So be vocal. That's something I would say.
And through that, you're also teaching your children how to ask for help. It is teaching your children how to say, I'm not okay. We want our children to be mm-hmm. well-rounded. We want them to have emotional intelligence. They learn this stuff from home. They learn how to, you model it when mm-hmm. you are able to say, mommy's not okay today. Mm-hmm. I don't feel good. I'm tired. I need for you to work with mommy today. And that way, when your kid is having a rough day and you can tell them, you remember that day mommy wasn't having a good day and I was tired. It sounds like you're having one of those kind of days. Do you need mommy to give you some time? Mm-hmm. Seriously. I've worked with children for the past 15 years, and I've learned so much from them about how they watch every little thing that we do,
and they
soak it up. My 5-year-old niece, who's my best friend, she's my baby. I have a few nieces and nephews, but this is, mm-hmm. we have a different bond, and I have really, really, learned a lot about having patience with her, but mm-hmm. also demonstrating and modeling for her. And so she repeats back a lot of stuff to me, mm-hmm. and she's able to identify her feelings and able to express them in an appropriate manner without having a meltdown, mm-hmm. because we are able to talk and communicate those things. So it is very important to recognize right now, you don't always have to go into someone's office. A lot of people are doing telehealth. Mm-hmm. And some of it is via video, or it could be via phone. It just depends. I know insurance companies are guiding a lot of that. And as therapists, mm-hmm. we are advocating for insurance companies to continue to pay for you to get these services. I know right now, at least for Blue Cross Blue Shield, if you have therapy insurance with them, you can utilize your benefits. I think it's to the mid of the month. You want to call and double check and confirm. But if you were doing telehealth sessions, then they waived your copay.
Okay, I want to back up. Ms. Ross said that it's very important you're working in a profession to make sure you're healthy and whole. We talk about that a lot because our profession, when it comes to giving, talking to people, and pouring into people, and that takes a lot of energy. So just make sure that you fill your cup back up, like you said earlier. And then she said, Felicia, yes, it's important for us to know, and our children to know it's okay to be human. And a lot of my friends criticize me about this, but I give my children space to tell me their feelings. They tell me they're upset, they're mad, they're having a bad day. And I'm teaching them self-care. I'm like, okay, get on the couch, get a blanket. You want me to bring you a juice box? What you want me to put on TV? You know, have you some time? So I'm teaching them it's okay to sit back and relax and take care of yourself. And then I give them the space to voice their emotions as well. Without, oh, I'm going to get you. You're going to be in trouble. Right. It's okay to say you're angry. You got nothing to be worried about. My kids are worried. They can't go to Chuck E. Cheese. They can't see their friends. Mm-hmm. My baby's like, I miss my friend Keandra. Where Keandra? My baby, the virus is out. We can't go to Chuck E. Cheese. Or just walking into Walmart and buying a toy. We can't do any of that. And I'm fortunate to be a homeowner, so I bought a lot of toys for outside, like a swimming pool, water toys, and we play in the water, mm-hmm. but everyone's not that fortunate, you know, to have a place to go and play because you're in an apartment or whatever the situation may be. So just try to find ways, because this is affecting our children's mental health too. They might not know how to express it, but it is.
And so that kind of segues mm-hmm. into one thing I want to make sure we kind of talk about and address is, how to kind of help take care of the little ones' mental health as well. We are going to see a lot of kids dealing with anxiety because they are scared. They don't know what's going on. So one of the first things we have to be careful of is how we're talking about things in front of them. Remember, their little brains don't process the way that ours do. And if we're struggling to process all of this because our way of life is gone, the way that we knew the world to be, that doesn't exist anymore. I don't think that anyone who's on this live right now can say that you grew up in a time where it wasn't the expectation and the norm that everybody went to public school. Maybe they started with the charter schools and all of that, but everybody was in school. There were some there are people who homeschool, but that by and large is not the culture of our society. And so the systematic educational system has been in place since we have all been here. And so that in itself is just a big blow to how we do life, because now parents are not just raising kids, they're having to do everything all the time and simultaneously. So you're having to work and make sure your kids are learning and make sure everybody could be on internet at the same time, making sure things are appropriate. And it is a struggle.
And my grocery bills like done triple, because I used to just feed them dinner because they're school and daycare. Three meals a day, snacks. Make too much money to get any type of help. And I'm like, well, how am I going to fit this in my budget? And so that's also been one of my biggest struggles is, okay, budgeting money to feed them all day, because I'm feeding them every day, all day now, not just dinner.
And so that's creating new norms and changing for people. And so with that and with all of this, we really have to do check-ins. Sit down and talk with your kids. They are human beings. Talk to them and ask them, even if it's a weekly check-in, where you've taken care of yourself, you give yourself a moment to come back and come back to them to be able to talk about, hey, just asking them questions, or if they come to you with questions, let them guide the discussion. And remember, these are children. Their brains don't process like ours from a developmental standpoint. Little kids tend to be black and white, literally. They have concrete thinking. And so, yes is yes, no is no.
They don't understand maybe.
What you mean maybe? Is that yes? So you gonna do it? So remembering that when you're talking to them, and if they ask you about something that you don't know, it's okay to say, you know what, baby, I don't know, but I'm going to learn. I'll learn and we can learn together, okay? You are teaching them it's okay not to know everything. You are teaching them to learn how to ask for help. You are teaching them to, you're teaching them critical thinking skills with this stuff as well. And so really sitting down, remember, kids don't often communicate with their words. Oftentimes it's through drawing or through play. And so play the way they want to play, and they will show you what they're seeing and what they're thinking about if you watch and demonstrate, watch how they demonstrate that and drawing and letting them free draw. I am not a play therapist. I know some play therapy techniques, but one of the things I've learned about using art in my work, and this is one thing I did love about working in schools, I told people I get paid to play all day. Because we did some heavy work, but I spent a lot of time playing with kids because that would get them to the point to where they would talk and open up. And so coloring, you can buy tons of things at the dollar store that can be beneficial. Coloring books, boards where you can draw on, flashcards, and then again, Pinterest is my friend. I utilize Pinterest a lot, even in my practice for the work that I do for activities. I am going to share a workbook with Ms. Fawn that's based around COVID-19, and it's a coloring activity book that she can email out or post you guys can utilize. It was developed through someone at Children's Hospital, and I have permission to share. So it's a great resource to use, and it helps to facilitate some conversation around that. I also shared some websites that are dealing with COVID and really speaking the language of kids to help them. So videos, everyone, these babies I know, I always talk about some YouTube. Mm-hmm. YouTube. I want to watch YouTube. So when they tell me that, I make them watch something educational, and mm-hmm. then they can watch their other stuff. So mm-hmm. find those videos, utilize those platforms for an educational purpose. And sometimes it helps to take the pressure off you to have all the answers. Mm-hmm. You don't have to have all the answers. Just learn to utilize your resources, and that could be helpful with that.
Mm-hmm. And then I had someone, Kamira, let me go back and read it. She, do you have coping skills for Black Lives Matter? So I know a lot of people are anxiety or whatever might be high now, because even me, I try to make sure I make the curfew. I don't want to be out at night anymore. So I try to make it my business to get home before night, because I don't want to be outside. So they want to know how to cope with that.
So one thing I'm going to say, I think yesterday I listened in on a managing anxiety training that was facilitated by two women who were white. And I asked the same question, because the things that they were talking about sounded cute, but it wasn't very helpful. It wasn't very practical for what I needed at the time. So I'm going to be honest and say that I can share a list of coping skills, because what I do believe is that if you don't do something to help regulate your system, then you'll stay on 10 all the time, and that's mm-hmm. not healthy. It's not healthy for your mind, it's not healthy for your body, and stress can kill you. And I don't want to hear of anyone dying because they blood pressure got too high, or they stroked out at 20-something, 30-something, 40-something because they were so stressed. Mm-hmm. So when thinking about coping skills, part of that is learning how not to hold stuff. Oftentimes we don't talk about this stuff. We feel shame because if there's some anxiety or stress, we feel like, well, I should be okay. I should be able to manage this. I tell people from day to day, my feelings have changed. My emotions have changed. Mm-hmm. And I manage it day to day. And I give myself grace for being a human and being in this forever changing world. And so we, as people of color, have had mm-hmm. this issue of not only are we dealing with COVID-19 and the fact that our communities are being hit harder due to systematic racism and issues in the healthcare field and other, along with other things, but not having proper access, not having proper food available in some communities, and having pre-existing health conditions, hypertension and things of that nature. So one is taking care of yourself, taking a minute, turn the TV off, get off of Facebook and Twitter and social media. You don't have to follow everything that's going on. And please stop watching these videos of people being murdered. A lot of people are not aware that when you expose yourself to this type of violence, it's even with certain movies, like I love psychological thrillers. I really do. It's something I like figuring out how people's brain works. And when I'm watching a movie that does that, mm-hmm. it's intriguing. There have been some movies that I will not watch. I'm like, nope. Mm-hmm. We're not doing that. I'm not fixing my spirit like mm-hmm. that with that information. I can't handle it. I can't handle watching another person of color be murdered. Mm-hmm. I refuse to watch it. I refuse to watch the violence. I refuse to expose myself to it, because what happens when you can't handle something is either you lose it or you start to minimize and you become numb. And we don't want to become numb, because that's what happened for so many years. People got numb, and you know, we mumble about it for a moment and all right, we're gonna go on. Mm-hmm. And so you want to feel, but you don't want to allow yourself to get to the point. Mental health is on a spectrum, just like mm-hmm. health. On the far left end of that spectrum, you have, that's it, they snap, they lost it. It's a psychotic break. It's a mental health breakdown. I have seen people have them. I have seen people go through the process of having them. It's nothing nice. And I'm not talking about patient and clients. I'm talking about family. Firsthand. Mm-hmm. And I felt when I started to have one. And for me, by the grace of God, it didn't happen.
Amen to that.
Mental health, you want to be in this sweet spot where you have some days it's a little off. You have some days that might be a little high, but you stay right here. Mm-hmm. Then you have people who are on the other end where they stay up all the time. And you ever see somebody who just all the time? I'm scared of people like that. That's not typical.
Me too. Or the people like has a dark cloud of all the time, everything's so negative.
Yeah. So you want to find some balance. And so one of the things is protecting your space, protecting your peace, and limiting your access and exposure. Don't get online arguing with these people unless you got time and have the energy to do it. Don't engage with people. If I see something and I see that it's starting to go somewhere left, I will mute the, keep put it where you can't come in on my page. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you're talking about. This is my page. I post what I want to. If you don't like it, okay.
That's what I told you guys. So this is my page and my block game is strong.
Yeah, so I will block people. I've been deleting people when I see this common thread with people where they're always negative or people are blaming folks for being murdered. Block. All lives matter, blocked. What you mean? I'm not doing that with you. I am in a lot of therapy groups with therapists. And I am blocking them folks too. And I'm leaving, you know, I haven't had to leave a group just yet because people are trying to do the work. But just being aware of those things. Also, again, the features of taking care of yourself. For some people, that's reading a book. For some people, that's just eating well. Don't let yourself binge out on everything that you know you don't need. If you've been trying to take care of your health, no, you may not be able to go to the gym. But YouTube got workout videos that are free.
You can take a walk in the open space. Keeping social distance.
And walk with the kids. Get the kids to do exercise. Let these babies get that energy out.
They need to.
Folks be mad at kids for running. Listen, as long as you don't hurt yourself, go. Go. Run all you want to. Because when I know when you get tired, unless you get this high bath, you finna go night night.
Yes.
So I have a list that I like to use, and it's a list of 100 coping skills that people can use. One thing I encourage people to do is continue to educate yourself. Educate yourself about our history and not just slavery. Our beginnings didn't start with no slavery. And even from the sense of how many of us got to the Americas, you have to, I wasn't trying to shame you with them chips.
What kind of chips you eating?
But just recognizing that there are other things about our history that we don't know. We don't want to do the work sometimes to learn about anybody other than Martin and Rosa and Malcolm. The library has a free app. If you have a library card, there's an app called Libby that you can download books. And you can download some Audible books and use those as well. So you can read more books for yourself. And a lot of things are open online. You have universities like Princeton and Harvard who are offering free classes. I know Ms. Vaughn mentioned that she got a certification, and I know I'm going to go get that certification, too.
My inbox been jumping. I share, baby. Sharing is caring.
And so, taking the time.
And I posted a resource for
thank you. Taking the time to get, to feed, build up yourself, and then educate your kids. One thing that my mother did for me when I was a child, and here's a child, grew up in a home with a single parent. She raised 4 children by herself. And my mom bought me African American encyclopedias. I was a reader. I love to read. And she would buy she bought that set for me. And I remember just being so intrigued. So when it was sixth grade maybe, and we had to do our history report for Black History Month. While everybody else doing the same typical people, I did Jesse Owens because he ran track, and I love track. So that worked for me. And so you see what a couple of years ago they did a movie about him. He was pretty dope. And we have tons of people like that. Learn about the history in Arkansas. There's so much that has happened in our state that we are not aware of, that we need to be aware of, so we understand where the activism is coming from and why some people are so, so sick and tired. Because this isn't just happening, you know, in Chicago and New York and California and Minnesota. It's Minneapolis. It's not happening just in these other places. It happens here as well. I grew up in small town USA, and there was a Black man killed in my community years ago by the police. And his family was well known, and they fought for justice. They never got not the way that it should have been. And so it's important that we educate ourselves. And I keep telling people, your advocacy is going to be different than other people. For me, getting my education, when I lived in New York, the Occupy Wall Street movement was going on, and I wanted to go so bad and participate and march. But I was a student, and I was paying for school. And I was the first person in my family who was going to get a PhD. I had to make a choice. Do I go stand and march, or do I sit here and fight in this classroom where I'm dealing with microaggressions and racism? And so I chose to do my work, and I chose to fight in that way. And I've had to encourage some other friends that what they're doing by still pursuing their education right now and still pursuing the certificate, by not giving up, by getting certified and learning new skills and trades, that's a form of resistance. For some people, it does mean going out there, boots on the ground. For some people, it means you praying and fasting for the people who are doing it. Each of us has a role to play, and learning, I think when we operate in that gives us some hope, because this situation can leave you pretty hopeless and fearful. I will share that on Tuesday, I was going walking downtown and was getting ready to walk across North Little Rock Bridge, and I noticed four police officers who were standing there, white police officers. Two of them had shotguns, and they were orange, so you could tell what they were. There was a group of Black women and kids walking kind of behind me, and as we came across, when another Black woman noticed, she froze up. I was on the phone, I had my earphones in, and I was walking, and I said, well, I see these officers, and I'm just gonna go add to the bridge block, because I'm trying to get my steps in. I have a challenge this month. I'm walking 100 miles this month, and so anybody wanna join? Come on, sis. And so, when I got up to them, I asked them, I said, hello, is the bridge blocked off? And they told me no, and they told me, to continue, you know, he said, oh, it looks like you are finishing. I was like, no, I'm actually just getting started. I said, I'm trying to get my steps in before the curfew. You gentlemen be safe and have a good night. And I went on about my business. What that did was gave those other women the opportunity to come on. I passed another group of Black women coming, and I said to them, it's cool to pass. I said, they're standing there for curfew. Now, I was walking by myself. It would have been easy to be like, I'm turning around, I'm going home. Okay. For me, that was my form of resistance, that I'm not going to turn around just because I see you. You don't get to keep me out of this space.
Exactly.
So I'm going to hold up space. I'm going to talk the way I talk when I'm near. I'm not going to change my voice unless I choose to. My voice is lighter because I work with babies, so I will change my voice for them.
I call it therapy voice.
Yes, it's my therapy voice. But I still be real serious.
Yes.
So, self-care, I mean, as far as the coping skills, doing the things to take care of yourself. So the coping skills are things that help us manage the stressors of life. This means also, if you have white friends, have conversations with them, but don't do the heavy lifting. I have told all my white friends, if you are expecting me, to give you some of this knowledge for free. You have lost your mind. I will not do your emotional labor. I will not. I'll send you my Cash App.
Right.
Or I'll share knowledge with you and you can send money after you show me a receipt that you send money to support a cause. Exactly. Put your money where your mouth is. I get paid to do what I do. I get paid to talk. And so I share this when I choose to, because this is another form of service for me. This is another mm-hmm. form of resistance for me, of helping people understand ways that they can better take care of themselves, for holding space for people and being able to share knowledge and information that I have with others, that so we can all be well. Mm-hmm. The ladies know we work in the wellness department, and I've told them since I started, in wellness, we will be well.
Yes.
So, she says she need her Cash App that she told you.
Who said that? The Camira? Tell her. We're going to talk about that later. Keep our business out the streets.
She says she helped you. She need her Cash App. So, any other questions around any of this? I know for some people, they're curious about how to have these conversations with their children. Mm-hmm. And for some of you, unfortunately, you've already had to have these conversations. So I just want to make you aware that tomorrow at 10 a.m., CNN and Sesame Street are having a town hall meeting. And I have a link for it, if you see it right there.
Okay. Well, if you can just email it to me real quick. Okay. I can try to look for it too.
So try to listen in to that tomorrow. And that would be a great opportunity to let some other people kind of talk. And mm-hmm. people from Sesame Street, they've been talking to all of us perhaps since we were kids. So mm-hmm. it's another great avenue and opportunity to have that hard conversation in a way that a child can mm-hmm. understand.
I think I found it. I'm gonna put this link in there.
So, okay. Just a few quick tips dealing with that issue. Check in with your child, because sometimes, and I promise this isn't about anything other than an observation. Sometimes we give kids these phones or tablets and we leave them to it. Make sure you have parental
controls
on your stuff so that they're not being exposed to videos that just pop up unexpectedly, or them going into something they don't need to see.
And another thing you can do with YouTube is you can take off the auto video, so mm-hmm. it won't keep playing videos. It'll just play that one video. So I put parental controls on everything, because I can't even damn care what you're watching. Because she just turned 5, so I didn't think. But I put parental control passwords on my Netflix, YouTube. Like, I had to lock it down. Tablets, we locked it down.
It's not even the kids who are doing it sometimes. It's just the way they advertise stuff. Mm-hmm. And so, but you want to check in with them to see what they have heard and what they're thinking and feeling. Because mm-hmm. especially if someone else is watching your children for you, sometimes people don't parent the way you parent. And they let kids hear and see everything on the news. They like, well, it's the nightly news. Well, mm-hmm. the nightly news is depressing
for us. It's depressing for me too.
So what do you think it's doing to the babies?
Exactly.
Watch for changes in your child's behavior. Some kids might become more aggressive or more withdrawn or becoming anxious. You want to pay attention to that. Limiting media. We've talked about this. Be aware of your own emotions and manage that. And then use it as a teachable moment and have an honest conversation in language that your child understands. A lot of time, us grown folk want to talk to little people and talk to them like they should understand the way we do. They mm-hmm. don't. Even being in the hospital, I was reminded a teenage patient, and was trying to talk to her about something. And I got bad news, but I had to squat it out. Mm-hmm. and talk to her and get on her level so she could hear me, because mm-hmm. everybody was used to talking over her. Mm-hmm. When I squatted and got to her level, we were able to connect. And I was able to, she told me everything I needed to know, and we were able to help. Mm-hmm. So, again, resources. There are books that you can find, free books. And some of them, you just find them online and read them out loud. You don't necessarily have to have them in person. And just remember, not talking about it doesn't make it go away. Mm-hmm. Ignoring it doesn't make it go away. And I think we have to find a balance. Mm-hmm. Someone recently told me that I'm not going to tell my kid who's five that his friends can't come over and play because they might get us sick and kill us all. He's like, I'm not going to do that. Mm-hmm. So I think you find the appropriate way. You know your child better than anyone. Some of y'all got kids who's smart and they sharp and they straight up no chaser. You come talking that foolishness to them, they going to look at you like, what? Why is you telling me it like that? That don't make sense. Right. Just tell me what it is.
I told you it was a virus, and I told about germs, and I like to do books and YouTube videos behind it to emphasize what I'm saying. And then I asked them to repeat back to me. Now, do you mm-hmm. understand? Well, tell me what mom just said, or if I'm disciplined. Why did you get in? Why did mommy take your test? What did you do? Okay, so what should you do? So I make it repeat it back to me, because they can say yes all day, but mm-hmm. you don't know if they're really understanding what you're saying until they can repeat some of that back to you. So that's one right. thing that I do.
And so that's going to be just important to keep in mind. And, you know, one thing I kind of want to leave with is just mm-hmm. understanding the difference in emotions and feelings. A lot of people are just like, why are people protesting? Why are people rioting? Mm-hmm. And the root of it, I believe, is the fact that you have...
And my son's up.
Oh, he just woke up.
Yeah, he
is. But you have people don't recognize anger. It's a secondary emotion. And so our primary emotions typically are fear, sadness, pain, grief, and even joy. Secondary emotions, anger, guilt, frustration, overwhelm, worry, irritability, anxiety. It's important to first recognize this in yourself mm-hmm. and recognize what's the root. Why do I feel angry? Why do I feel frustrated? Why do I feel this? And then once you get to the root of it, it could be managed. Mm-hmm. When I look at what's going on, what I see is the secondary emotion being displayed based off of the primary emotion. A lot of us are sad. Mm-hmm. We are grieved mm-hmm. that in 2020 we are still having to wear these same mm-hmm. shirts. We have to carry the same sign saying our mm-hmm. life matters. Stop killing our black men and women. Stop killing our babies. Stop killing us.
Right.
And it's disheartening because it goes, what has all this been for?
Right.
What's wrong with people? Mm-hmm. And recognizing that it's not a us problem. We got some issues, mm-hmm. but this ain't a us problem. This is an accountability mm-hmm. issue that has never been addressed. And so when you see people who are breaking stuff and tearing it up and burning it down, this is the result of years of built up tension and anger. Of mm-hmm. course, there are some people who mm-hmm. are thrown in this mix from other places. Of course, mm-hmm. there are people who are opportunists. That's always going to exist. Mm-hmm. But the large majority of people are responding out of a primary emotion of, I'm just sad. Mm-hmm. I'm grieved. And I don't know what else to do because I've tried to march. I've tried to kneel. I've tried to write y'all. I've tried to talk to y'all. Y'all ain't been listening. And so keeping that in mind and having that conversation with the kids, because the news is only showing one side. Mm-hmm. So make sure you're getting your information from more than one source. And don't take everything that you see on the news as law. You have to have some discernment. Mm-hmm. To understand what's going on in these times, and times are changing, and change don't feel good. It never does. But what's being birthed, I think we're in a birthing process mm-hmm. in this country. And who had their baby in the week? You got pregnant, you had the baby in the week.
I
wish. That ain't how it worked. In order for your baby to get mm-hmm. here healthy, you had to go through that process mm-hmm. and it took some time. So let's keep that in mind, because that's what we're doing right now. We're going through a process mm-hmm. and it's going to take some time for some healing. It's going to take some time for understanding, but we are seeing more and more businesses and companies and people. Did y'all see them folks in Harrison, Arkansas?
I was like, Harrison. People say don't go to Harrison. Definitely don't go there at nighttime, but you don't need to go there at all.
Don't stop
in Harrison.
them folks out there protesting.
Yes.
When I tell you things are changing. Mm-hmm. So in the meantime, we gotta take care of ourselves because mm-hmm. we don't wanna be the people who miss the other side of it.
Right, right.
So take the time to take care of yourself. Take the time to talk to your children so that they can grow up emotionally healthy. Mm-hmm. So they can grow up informed mm-hmm. about what's going on and appropriate how. And they could determine for themselves how they want to engage and participate in exactly. the process.
Exactly. I'm going to say two quick things and I'm going to let it go. And then also just me having friends of different races to understand that just because I'm pro-black doesn't mean that I have a problem with you. So I try to make my friends of other races aware of that. And then to explaining different races to your kids, because Taylor came to me and was like, I'm brown, mom, but she's white. And I had to explain to her about melon mm-hmm. and why you're dark and that your black is beautiful. She said she's brown. She's not black. She's brown. But her brown is beautiful. And I started buying her clothes instead with melon or things and books and just being intentional about putting people in front of her that look like her. So I think we definitely need to have a race conversation, no matter what race you are, because I know everyone in the group is not African-American, so we need to be having talks with our children about different races. So I think that's important.
And it is important, and it's important to be okay to say people are different. Mm-hmm. Can we please get away from this? I don't see color. Are you colorblind?
And even if you're colorblind, you see something different. It's distantly coordinated. I know that you may see green, you may see red, gray, but you're seeing
something.
It don't all look the same.
Now, anybody who knows race, of course, it's a social construct. We mm-hmm. won't get into all of that. The reality is that it does have an impact in our society on how people are viewed, how people are mm-hmm. treated. And no matter, I don't do respectability politics. I don't care how many degrees I got or any of that other stuff. Some people see me and they still think, oh, she's an angry black woman because I'm assertive and I open mm-hmm. my mouth and say what I need to say. I'm like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. If yeah. that's what you need to call me to feel better, but you still finna get this work.
Yes.
And it's going to be in a very polite manner, but I won't dumb myself down. I won't stop going for my walks. I won't stop going for my teas. I won't stop mm-hmm. living my life and taking up space because it makes someone uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And so a large part of this is people are scared to have conversations, and it's important to have these open, honest conversations and have dialogue. And so for anybody who may not be African American and you want help with having these conversations, talk to the people closest to you. They might mm-hmm. be willing to do some of that laboring with you. And each person has that right and choice. I have personally taken the stance that I'm not doing the labor for anybody else mm-hmm. because I don't have the capacity mm-hmm. to do the work that I'm doing now in so many spaces and holding spaces for people and to do that. Mm-hmm. Listen, I won't even go into, because I hate when people are like, well, I got white people. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm just not doing it. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have nothing to do with who in my family, who married to who, or any of that. Mm-hmm. It's just a choice I get to make, and right. other people get to make a choice as well.
Exactly.
So it's just important to be informed and know what's going on, and so you can make an informed choice mm-hmm. about whatever it is that you choose to do.
All right. Thank you, ladies, for watching. Thank you, Dr. Flowers, for coming on. I really appreciate you.
I enjoy it.
Like, go ahead. Where
no, I just said I enjoyed it. Thank you for having me.
And I enjoyed it too. I learned a lot too. So we're going to say thank you guys for watching. We love you. Take care. Be safe. Okay. All right, y'all. Have a good weekend. There, we get you home.
'Cause I seen
you
this shit.
No. And I posted too when you sent me that. Mm-hmm. If you don't mind sending me the Sesame Street thing too.
Oh, okay.
Oh, so is Little Rock too good? I just want to make sure you get home at a decent time. Oh, I gotta put me on the rest of this music on here so it won't cut me off.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta forgot to do that. I don't know if I can edit it. Maybe I can do it after I post it. Let's fucking do it from here.
So I just sent you that email.
Okay. I'm see if I can put that on there so they don't clip me out. Let me see if that was in the stream. I'm going to have to post it and then try to get it.